Hello, my name's Leanne Longfellow, and I'm going to be talking about 10 steps to be an ally to students with disability. So I'll just introduce who I am. So my background is that I was a teacher for 30 years. I have a daughter with a disability who's now an adult. And so that sort of propelled me into the disability community and getting very involved in advocacy. I ended up doing a lot of study. I did 5 degrees and ended up with a doctorate where I looked at education and disability. I founded an educational consultancy that's very much based on social justice for students with disabilities. And I also have a disability myself. I'm hard of hearing. So today we're looking at the Professional Standards 1.6, strategies to support the full participation of students with disability. So the outline of this talk today is I will talk about the learning intention, the big picture of what I'm trying to achieve, and there will be two success criteria. And these, the learning intention and the success criteria, will be revisited at the end of the session. Then I'm going to be talking about the definition of what an ally is. You might be quite familiar with that term. It has been made very popular during the Black Lives Matter movement, but it's a term that's used a lot with marginalised groups, and certainly in the disability community, there's a lot of talk about how to be an ally. I'll talk briefly about the evidence base, because it's really important that whatever we do has an evidence base. I'll talk about the key concepts behind the philosophy of social justice for students with a disability. Then I'll talk about the 10 steps to being an ally. And then at the end, as I said, we will revise the learning intention and success criteria. The learning intention, and that is the big picture of what I'm trying to achieve here, is to introduce the concept and practice. And the word practice has an S, so it's a verb rather than a noun. So it's what we are doing. So hopefully this will be a practical exercise that you can go away and have actions that you can implement. So it's to introduce the concept and practice of being an ally as a means of instigating cultural change required for successful, inclusive education. And the success criteria, and there's only two, but the first one is I can state at least one action I can immediately implement in order to be an ally to students with disability. And number two is I can name at least one long-term goal to work toward in order to be an ally to students with disability. And the evidence. So it's really important that there is an evidence base behind everything that we do. And there is a very large evidence base for what I'm talking about. It's largely from people with lived experience of disability. By lived experience, I mean people who personally have a disability themselves. A lot of people that have lived experience of disability have been involved in research and are reflecting upon their time in education. And we've even got students currently in education who are providing their narratives and stories about how they think education can be transformed to be more inclusive. Certainly at Flinders University, there's a lot of research that is done with people with a disability. And this research is largely qualitative, so that's through words, through interviews, because what we found is that quantitative research with statistics, often it isn't inclusive of people with disabilities. Quantitative research largely involves getting the perspective of people who are non-disabled about what they think about disability, but we really need to hear it from people who have a disability. So that's what I'll be talking about. And, you know, the term ally came from many years ago in the 1970s. It was used for marginalised groups, and I'll be explain that a bit more later. But it's really important, the whole idea of working with people with a disability. The definition of an ally. So an ally is someone who advocates for a marginalised group, but they are not a member of the group. So being an ally means using your position and capacity to address structural inequality. And we certainly do have structural inequality all throughout our society. Inequality works against the inclusion of students with disability. In this session, you'll be introduced to 10 steps that we can take toward being an ally to make classrooms and schools safe, welcoming spaces for students who have disabilities. And I'll also just point out that I'm using the term students with disability, and this is really contentious. A lot of people with disability like to be called disabled people. They like the word disability being first rather than saying, you know, person with disability. But I've chosen to use the term students with disability because that is the phraseology in the National Disability Strategy. And it's kind of an in-between space. So hoping that by using this terminology that I'm not offending anybody. I certainly respect the way that people prefer to self-identify. And if people prefer to identify as disabled, I greatly respect that. But just using this for largely for the parent community who may not be aware of disability pride, and children often haven't been introduced to the idea of disability pride. So saying students with disability is kind of that, just that in between until. In terms of being an ally, it's very much about being on the side of the person who is marginalised. So it's an attempt to avoid the whole hero-victim narrative, which happens a lot when you have a marginalised group. And even the word marginalised is a bit problematic. But what can often happen, and certainly what has happened in the disability community, is that there's a whole lot of research and work about disability, but it's largely led by non-disabled people. So the whole idea of being an ally is partnering with the disability community for social justice. So not doing things for them, but doing things with them, and avoiding the whole hero-victim narrative, which happens an awful lot with the very, very best of intentions, but it only serves to disempower disabled people. So the whole idea of being an ally is to amplify the voice of students with disabilities and teach them to self-advocate, but being there right behind them. And there's a saying in the disability community, nothing about us without us. So with that quote very much in mind, this is what this PD is founded on. So now I'm going to introduce you to the key concepts behind this PD. If you've heard these key concepts before, that's fantastic. Some of you, it might be the very, very first time. And some of these concepts are quite heavy and there's been a lot of debate about them. I'm going to introduce them just in a very simple way, but I'm also going to provide links and resources that if you want to read up a bit more about these concepts, you can do so and explore them a bit further. So the first one is the medical model of disability versus the social model of disability. And I'm going to introduce this in a really simple way. I've spent years reading about this, and it's a very complex concept. So I'm going to just do a very snapshot presentation of what this is about. and you are welcome to do more reading about it. But basically, the medical model of disability, which is what our education system is based on, is where we see students with a disability, they're the ones who intrinsically have a problem, so we need to fix them so that they can fit into education better. The opposite of that is the social model of disability, and this social model was introduced way back in the 1970s by a group of men in the UK who had physical disabilities, and what they said was that the environment needs to be changed. They do not need to be changed as disabled people. It's the environment that is unwelcoming. And this whole idea of the social model of disability, looking at the environment and changing the environment and changing attitudes towards people with disability, has very much influenced everything that we do throughout the world regarding people with a disability. Our National Disability Insurance Scheme was founded on the social model of disability, and it's now the preferred way of viewing people with a disability. And in terms of education, the whole idea of using the social model is that we look at the environment and look to change that. And it means that not only will the student with a disability be welcomed and can participate and feel valued and included, but it also means that there's a whole lot of students who may not fit in and may not have a label in any way. But all those people who feel kind of on the margins of education, feel a bit marginalised, that all of those people will also be included. And because inclusive education is not just about disability, it's about everything, you know, religion and social class and race and everything. And so inclusive education is making sure that our classrooms and schools value diversity, value all forms of difference. There's a picture in front of you of someone in a wheelchair, and then there is a flight of steps. This is a visual to explain the social model of disability. So when we look at that picture, we can ask the question, where is the barrier? Is the barrier to access the fact that someone is in a wheelchair, or is the barrier to access the steps? And of course it's the steps, and if we change the steps and had ramps, then not only would the person in a wheelchair have access, but there will be a whole lot of other people that have access to a building. And of course this is very simplified. There's the stereotypical picture of disability, which is someone in a wheelchair, and what we know is that the majority of people with disabilities have invisible disabilities, and we know that it's not just the physical environment that is not welcoming, that probably the biggest barrier to inclusive education is attitudes and the way that we have been socially conditioned to think about disability. But this is just a visual, just to get you thinking about the fact that the barriers to access and participation and being valued reside in the environment. Ableism is one of the concepts that I'll be talking about today. And it's a pretty heavy concept, and it's one that not a lot of people have been introduced to. We are very familiar with racism and sexism, but not so much with ableism. Although, I have to say, the last few presentations that I've done, I've mentioned the word ableism and people know all about it. So that's been really, really exciting. But ableism, it's like the other isms, such as racism and sexism, and it's discrimination towards a social group, and it classifies people as less than. So it rests on the assumption that disabled people need to be fixed. It can include harmful stereotypes, misconceptions, and generalisations of people with disabilities. Ableism in schools can include segregation of students, nil or inadequate adjustments, inaccessible spaces, venues, excursions, not supplying reasonable adjustments, bullying, sidelining, isolating, well-meant but harmful comments, and framing disability, viewing disability as either tragic or inspirational, or having low expectations of students with disabilities. I'm currently participating, or I'm a researcher, a co-researcher at Flinders University, and we are looking at ableism in education. And we launched our survey on the weekend, and we've just been delighted that with the response. So over the weekend, we had over 100 submissions to our survey from a whole range of people, and who have realised and they stayed in the survey that, you know, ableism is a problem in our society, and it's also evident in our schools. So it's something that does need to be acknowledged that it exists so that it can be addressed. We cannot address it until we label what it is. This talk is all about having that paradigm shift, and a paradigm shift, that mind shift from fixing disability to fixing oppression. And what we know is that disabled people very much feel oppressed in our society. We know that through the research, and we know through the Disability Royal Commission has had a huge focus on education. It started with inclusive education, and I think they've had numerous, about four sessions on inclusive education, because what education can do is it has a multiplier effect for students with a disability. So if we get it right in education and open up opportunities for students with disabilities, it can impact every area of their life. So in terms of employment, housing, opportunities, and just living the good life. So this talk is very much about cultural change that we need in our society and in our schools so that all students feel welcomed and valued. I'm going to move into our 10 steps now, and the first one is self-reflection, and it's the core of what we're talking about. So self-reflection is really, really important. So the first one is I self-reflect on who I am and how my identity and life experiences shape my beliefs on how I interact with students with disability. Many of us have not encountered students with a disability or people with a disability in our lives. Many of us do not have friends who have a disability. And we may have been, and most probably have been, socially conditioned to think of disability as a deficit and a negative experience. But when we talk with people with a disability and they want to promote the idea of having a positive disability identity. So it's really good if we are able to self-reflect and think about different ways of thinking about disability. Why do we need to self-reflect? So our values and beliefs affect our teaching, particularly with students with disabilities. So we're naturally oblivious to our own position because we've been socially conditioned to think a certain way. And so we're oblivious to the impact we have on our students, the classroom culture and our schools. While it's relatively straightforward to remove physical barriers to make sure that schools and classrooms are accessible and to implement inclusive pedagogies, it's much harder to examine ourselves. And it's a really tricky thing to examine ourselves. But this is what I'm going to be asking you to do, to consider self-reflection and ways of doing that. Some other things for you to consider are the biases that we have in our society. And what we know is that there are different forms of biases. So there's affinity bias, where we unconsciously prefer people who share the same qualities as we do. And we see this in, there's a lot of research on that, certainly in employment. What we know is that people who do the hiring, who are in HR, tend to prefer people like them. But what we know is that workplaces that are diverse and schools that are diverse are much healthier places. So appearance bias. So we've got this rigid set of standards in regards to appearance. And, you know, there are certain things that we are socially conditioned to believe are preferred. And, you know, we are all prejudiced and we all have biases. Conformity bias is another one. Our views, we tend to prefer people who share the same views that we have, the same opinions. And there's confirmation bias, and that refers to how people primarily search for bits of evidence that back up their opinions. And I know I've certainly done that at times, and that's why it's also good to be in a community that is a safe community and to have a critical friend who can point out when you're doing these things. Because these just come naturally to us as human beings. We are biased as human beings, and it's really good to be in a safe space for people to tell you when you are being biased. And attribution bias, that refers to how you perceive your actions and those of others, and stems from our flawed ability to assess the reasons for certain behaviours. So basically, we are biased individuals and we need to self-reflect in order to overcome our social conditioning. I've used the word social conditioning a lot, and so here are just some labels that automatically come to our mind. When we see someone with a disability, we have been socially conditioned to apply these labels to them. So labels such as failure, less able, burden, sad, brave, tragic, invalid. There's research to say that when we see someone who is different from ourselves, the very first thought that comes to our mind is one that we have been socially conditioned to believe, and we're not responsible for that very first thought. So it's the way that we've been brought up, our communities that we are involved in, the language that we have been socially conditioned to believe. So the very first thought that we have in when we are exposed to diversity, we are not responsible for, but the second thought we are responsible for. And so that is why it's really important to self-reflect and to think about the language that we use and the labels that we utilise. So this is a poem by a man called Donald Rumsfeld, who was part of the American government many years ago. So this poem was said, I believe, at a press conference, and half of the people thought this is just wonderful, but he also received a lot of ridicule for this poem at the time, because people thought, oh, he's just trying to be cryptic and clever. And I'll just read this. As we know, there are known knowns. There are things we know we know. We also know there are the known unknowns. That is to say, we know there are some things we do not know, but there are also unknown unknowns, the ones we don't know, we do not know. Finally, there are unknown knowns, the knowns we do not want to know. And it does sound a bit cryptic, and at the time, people had a bit of a laugh at Donald Rumsfeld, and they thought it was a bit of nonsense. But this poem is used a lot throughout the world, and in fact, when I did my PhD, it was introduced to me very early on, because the whole notion of that we all have blind spots, and there are things that we know that we don't know, but then there are also the unknown unknowns. So certainly in the disability community, there are, if we don't have a lot of exposure to the disability community and don't have friends who have a disability, there are things that we do not know, that we don't know, the unknown unknowns. We'll be talking a bit more about ways to develop awareness of what we don't know so that we can develop our capacity to be an ally for students with a disability. So this is a checklist. This is a resource that I developed for an inclusive toolkit. This was a government-funded project, and it's available online. And this is just a little resource for us to become aware of all those things that we are socially conditioned about, that we take for granted, our unknown unknown. So this is a little checklist, and there will be a link to this if you would like to utilise this. You can utilise it personally. You can use it at a staff meeting. It's just a great way of checking our own beliefs about what we think about students with a disability. And then there are ratings. So there's a sentence such as, students with disability have little in common with students without disability. And then you rate this. At the end, you tally up your score and work out, you know, where you were sitting in terms of your social conditioning. And within the resource, it also explains each pointer. So number two is, students with intellectual disabilities receive a better education in special schools or special classes. There's 40 years of research to say that actually they have better outcomes in inclusive settings. And the resource explains that. You know, number three, the financial cost of making schools accessible is too high. That's addressed in the resource, that if we have inclusive education, it's at the same cost. I feel sorry for students with disability, so that's addressed in this resource. Professionals know what is best for students with a disability. What we know is it really needs to be a partnership. Friendships, number six, friendships. Students with disabilities will not make friends in general education. That's something that we hear a lot. It's one of those myths. There's a lot of research to say that if we support students having friendships, then they will. And they will go on and have those friendships after school, once they've left school. And hopefully they can have a good life and have those enduring friendships. Number seven, here's another myth. Inclusion has a negative impact on students without disabilities as their learning can be compromised. The research actually tells us that having a student with a disability in the classroom makes the learning environment improved and more accessible for everyone. Number eight, inclusion is a fad that legitimises a marketplace for inclusive programs. It's not a fad. It's been around for 40 years. And certainly there's been a huge shift, I feel, in the past few years towards looking at inclusive education. Number nine, teachers do not have the skills to teach students with disability. And I'm talking about teachers in general education. And what we know is that if you've been to university and you have a teaching degree, you can teach all children. You are qualified to teach all children, and that's really important for us to acknowledge. You may need support with that, but we are all qualified to teach all children. And students with disabilities will be bullied in general education settings. And there's a whole lot of research on that to say that bullying is equal in general education and in special education. So this resource aims to address our social conditioning and these myths with the evidence base. And this slide is just the factual statements on that stem from the evidence. There is 40 years of evidence on inclusive education. So this is addressing those myths that we all have. We all have these myths because we are all socially conditioned to think about students with disability and inclusive education in certain ways. And this is a bit of a deep slide, but I've thrown it in there because I think it's really important. If all of this language is new to you, please do some more reading about this, because this is really important. But I talked about ableism before, and the medical model is very much an ableist model, where it promotes negative beliefs and discrimination about disability. So there are things called disability microaggressions. So that's where people have the best of intentions and try to be kind and helpful, but it's their statements or actions may be ableist. And there's a lot of ableist language in our society. I'm in a number of Facebook groups with disabled people, and words that are thrown around in general society, such as the word idiot, is banned in those groups because it's ableist and it has a really tragic history. So it's important that we acknowledge words like that that are used to oppress people, particularly people with intellectual disabilities. And if we look back on the history of IQ tests and how IQ tests have been used against disabled people, and it has also been used, you know, to really oppress people, been used in eugenics programs, and it's quite horrifying, the history behind words like idiot that we use in a way not to harm people with disability, but the fact that the history is really loaded, it can be troubling, and it can be make it unsafe for disabled people who are very, very aware of the tragic history for people with a disability. And it's not just history. You know, in our COVID pandemic, I'm in lots of Facebook groups where disabled people are worried that, you know, if we had COVID sweep through our society, that, and there was a choice between a non-disabled person and a disabled person for a ventilator, the disability community believe that the non-disabled people would be preferred because of all the deficit beliefs about disability. There's a very long, tragic history with our language, and there are social divisions, disability stereotypes, and I've talked previously about unconscious bias. So all of that together can make schools and classrooms quite unsafe. And that's why it's really important as an assistant or as a teacher that we can be an ally and make schools and classrooms as safe as possible through, and in the middle there I've got critical thinking and self-reflection and listening to people with lived experience of disability. That's really important. And we can transform our schools and classrooms to being positive places where there is awareness, where there is social capital. That's where our students with disabilities are encouraged to have friendships with a whole range of other students, where our language is inclusive, where the environment is welcoming, where there is participation and social justice. So using the social model, we are mindful of the impact of an unequal society within our classrooms and within our schools. Thinking about self-reflection, what I'd like you to think about is what action will you take? And it's hard when it's the unknown unknowns, but just thinking about reflections that you can do, whether that is through journaling, whether it's through being part of a group, being involved in Facebook groups, in education groups. I have a Facebook group called Inclusive Education in Australia, and we try to be self-reflective about language. In fact, a parent of a child with a disability asked the question the other day about the term special needs, and we all, different people, jumped in and self-reflected about the need to change that term and the impact on students with a disability. Think about ways that you can self-reflect and critically reflect about your identity and your beliefs. Number two, being a role model, and that's really important. So as a teacher or assistant, I recognise that I'm a role model for the children or students I encounter, and what I do is more powerful than what I say. And it's really important that we're not just saying words. So if we're changing language, if we remove words like special needs and change it for something else, such as, you know, just the term disability, or if we change from special education to inclusive education, that what we're doing is really aligned with what that word means. So we're not just promoting memes and not doing anything about it, that we actually live out what we say that we are doing. So what action will you take there? So once again, I think it's really important to be part of a community, a really safe community where people can challenge you. And it's because of our social conditioning, we are all going to make a lot of mistakes. I make a lot of mistakes. And just the other day, I'm in this research team and I made a comment about children who have a disability who are not able to speak and are nonverbal. And someone said to me, children can communicate in a variety of ways. So it's always best to say that rather than describe them as nonverbal. And the funny thing is, I've often said that myself in PD, but then I flip back to using the term nonverbal. And so it's really good being in that safe space for someone to say, oh, look, you know, how about you not do that? And without taking offence as well, I think it's very easy to take offence when someone suggests that we change something about the language that we use or the actions that we do, but it's about looking at it as an opportunity to do the right thing and be an ally to students with a disability. Number three, internalised thoughts. And we've talked a bit about this already, but I'll just go a bit more in depth on this. We all have internalised thoughts. And as I said before, the first thought that comes to our mind, we are not responsible for. We've been socially conditioned to believe that. But our internalised thoughts and ideas about children and students with disability are from the past. These thoughts and ideas may not help address issues of inequity, discrimination, and stereotyping. I'm going to go through a few movies which are problematic movies. And the reason that I've chosen these movies is a lot of English teachers in secondary school utilise these texts, and movies can be a text that they analyse. And a lot of secondary English teachers like to do comparative texts. Million Dollar Baby is a film that is very popular, and there's also a book that the film was based on. And basically it's a movie about a woman who, very working class woman, who becomes a boxer and becomes very wealthy and famous. And then she has an accident and is paralysed and needs support for her breathing. At the end, the woman who is disabled decides that she wants to die, and Clint Eastwood helps her with that. And that's at the end of the movie, and her ventilator is removed. The interesting thing is that non-disabled people think, yes, if that happened to me, that is the choice that I would make. And certainly the movie makes it look really dramatic, having quadriplegia and not being able to move. Non-disabled people think, yes, you know, that is what I would choose. But it's interesting that there's a lot of disabled people in this situation who say, no, you know, my life is worthwhile. I want to live my life. And so they challenge. There's been a lot of research on this movie, on Million Dollar Baby, and how it presents disability in a way that is not accurate. And it silences the voice of disabled people. And I'll take you through a few movies where there have been protests about movies because of the way that disability is portrayed in the movie. So here's another one that was recently released, The Witches. In this movie, and this is based on a Roald Dahl book, in the movie they had the main person, her hands were made to look like a disabled person's. There's a certain disability where people have hands like this. And in The Witches, this was presented as, you know, this person had similar traits to people with disabilities, and yet she's presented as an evil person. So often disability is equated with being evil. This movie received a lot of complaints from the disability community, and thankfully the producers of the movie and the actors in the movie gave an apology to the disability community for oppressing disabled people. So this movie had a very good outcome in terms of addressing problems. Here's another movie that the disability community find completely offensive, Jojo Moyes' book Me Before You. Once again, these movies and books are written by non-disabled people who try to imagine what the life is like for someone who is disabled without ever talking to anyone who is disabled, which the disability community find quite offensive. So Me Before You is about a young man who's got everything going for him, and he develops quadriplegia. He has this carer who, you know, this attractive young woman, and they fall in love, and he says to her, well, my life is not worth living because I'm disabled, so please help me die. And so that's the ending of it. It's, you know, there's a lot of the theme of I've either got to be cured or I've got to be killed runs through a lot of movies, and we really do need to critically reflect on that. Yeah, it's rare to have a movie where a person who has a disability lives a good life, and yet I have many disabled friends who live really good lives, and I've got friends who have quadriplegia who are quite happy with their life. So they find movies such as this problematic and offensive, and we need to critically reflect on whether this is a true portrayal of disability. This is another movie that was released, I think it was at the beginning of the year, Sia's movie Music, and it had someone playing an autistic person. There was a huge outcry from the autistic community, and part of the problem was Sia, who has a disability herself. You can have a disability yourself and still be ableist. And Sia did this in this movie. She put a lot of time and effort into it and thought it was wonderful. But there was a huge backlash, huge protest, because the way the autistic character is portrayed was really quite offensive. And as the autistic community said, there could have been someone with autism to play that role, and to play it in a respectful role. And the reason that I'm talking about these movies is that these movies impact our beliefs, and they're part of our social conditioning. And if we do not critically reflect on them, and if we do not touch base with the disability community to check their thoughts on it, then it's easy to keep going the way that we are with our social conditioning and think of disability as a deficit. So here's a picture. I took this off Twitter, and it's from an American page. And I did that deliberately because I didn't want to use an example of an Australian, just in case someone had some connection with them. But this happens a lot in America, and it also happens a lot in Australia. So here's a young woman with Down syndrome who is off to a prom, and there's a non-disabled student who offered to partner her. And this happens a great deal in the US. And on Twitter, and this wasn't that long ago actually, on Twitter the comments below, you can see at the time that I took this screenshot of it, there were 1,787 comments and over 36,000 people liked this. And look, nice thing, but what we need to look at is the comments that were made. You know, all the comments are, he is such a good person. I don't know how many people said that. What an amazing young man. He is a hero. This is extraordinary. Isn't she lucky that he took her to the prom? How inspiring. What I'd like you to do is just to have a think. What is the problem with these statements? Is there a problem with these statements? And just have a think about that. Hopefully you've been able to reflect on this. And the problem is that the comments are all about the non-disabled man who is receiving a huge amount of attention for partnering with this young woman who has Down syndrome. And the focus is very much on him. And so, you know, there's a power play here. He's the one that has all the power. He's the one getting all the attention. And for her, the statement, isn't she lucky? Well, you know, I think she's just living the good life and going to a prom, and he's the one getting all the attention. And it's actually quite offensive that the focus is on him. We really need to think about our relationships with students with a disability. And when we encourage friendships, that they are equal status friendships, and that's really important. And we see that when friendships do occur, you know, social media can be such a great thing but such a curse. I've seen a lot of cases of non-disabled people filming the whole thing and putting it up on social media, and it's all about them. And that is the problem with it, and that it is ableist. Because, you know, maybe that young man is the lucky one that she went along with him. That was not mentioned at all in the comments. And how inspiring. She's just doing what all the other girls in her year are doing, going to a prom, and yet it's labelled as inspiring. So that is a problem. So we need to critically reflect on that sort of language and that idea that she is lucky for someone to take her to a prom. And think about other ways of approaching friendships and relationships and connections. So what action will you take here? So once again, journaling, being part of a safe community, possibly even voicing concerns. And I think you can do that respectfully. You know, offering an alternative viewpoint once you've critically reflected. So if you were on Twitter or LinkedIn or Facebook, or even talking at a staff meeting about other actions and other ways of using language so that it's not stigmatising and it doesn't oppress students with a disability, and so that we can be an ally for students with a disability. Building capacity. So this is number four. I acknowledge that I need to build my capacity and understanding of the rights and needs of children and students with a disability. One of the ways of building capacity, and I think it's really important, that we do some PD with disabled people and touch base with them. So if we wanted to learn about autism, and there was an autism PD, it would be really good if you could question whether the presenter or the facilitator of that actually identified as having autism, or whether the PD was developed in conjunction with an autistic person. I think that is a great way of building capacity. And once again, being in groups with safe places where you can have critical friends to talk about ways of building capacity. But touching base with the disability community is really important. And as I said before about, you know, if you went to a PD on autism, it's really important that that disabled people had input into the development of the PD, because disability-related issues are usually taught by non-disabled people from a clinical perspective based on the medical model of disability. A clinical approach encourages segregation. And disability is not necessarily a medical issue, it's a social and political one. So it's really important that we have disabled people have input into PD, and so that we get that social justice perspective. With my hearing loss, my audiologist can tell me a great deal, and a great deal more than I know about my hearing loss, but he wouldn't necessarily understand about the oppression that I experience, how difficult it is navigating my way through society, or, you know, how difficult it is that my daughter has a disability. We go to the cinema together, she needs the wheelchair spaces in the cinema, but that often in those seats, I do not have access to closed captioning. So just those little things which make life very, very difficult, I think it's important that we become aware of that rather than just the clinical perspective. And what action will you take in regard to that? So the next one, number five, be a resource. I seek to be a resource to other teachers and assistants on the education of children, students with disability, and to do what I can to advance the cause of inclusion. So being a resource, it could be just sharing your knowledge with others in whatever way you can, whether that's in the staff room or directing people to PD that's led by people with disabilities or has had input from people with disabilities. So ableist language, we need to be able to define and identify ableist language before we can act as an ally to students with disability. So ableist language is more than a list of words that creates personal offence. Rather, it is language that is used, often unconsciously, to marginalise other and oppress disabled people. So some ableist terms are disability slurs, for example, retarded and idiot, and I talked a bit about the word idiot before, while others are not inherently ableist, but become so in context. For example, using the term autism as a synonym for self-centred or lacking empathy, that is ableist. So what action will you take in this regard? So the next one, acknowledging tension. So as an ally for children and students with disability, I acknowledge that tension exists between the different stakeholders involved in the education of children and students with disability. I had a teacher touch base with me the other day saying that she felt somewhat frustrated at a meeting where there was a student who was had an intellectual disability, and the first suggestion in the meeting was that he should have a special class placement, and she was suggesting that no, better supports could be put in place in his general education class. And she felt quite frustrated by that. And I think what we need to do is just to acknowledge it's not going to be easy. It's going to be tricky. There are people who have a different viewpoint, who may not have been exposed to the disability community and may not understand the social justice issues and may not understand the research behind inclusive education. And we just need to accept that it's not going to be easy. Tension will exist, and we just need to be confident and to have our safe place of supporters that build us up, knowing that as an ally we are doing the right thing. But meetings can be tense, and that's just the way it is, just a fact of life and working with others. So what action will you take here? How will you address that tension will exist? How will you find a group, a safe place for you to be part of? So accountability. I don't expect to be taught how to address equity issues, but I'm prepared to be held accountable for the way I respond to children, students with disability, and their families and guardians. So in terms of equity issues, the disability community spend a lot of time addressing equity issues, and they do that because it's very important to them, but they often do that as a sideline. They're often asked to work without pay to address equity issues and to sort things out for non-disabled people who tend to be in leadership and paid roles, and yet they rely on unpaid help from the disability community. So it's really important that we don't place expectations on the disability community to address those equity issues, that we seek ways of looking for answers ourselves or in a community. But we also need to be held accountable for the way that we respond and for building our own capacity and our own understanding about disability. It's really important that we do that. So what action will you take there? Discussing equity. I choose to be actively involved in spaces that discuss issues of equity within education. I acknowledge that these conversations may be uncomfortable. So equity is a really important concept. So being equal means just sharing. So if we had a chocolate cake and we had 15 children in our class and we just cut it into equal pieces, that's equality. But equity is looking at the children and saying, well, you know, one has a gluten intolerance and there's another one who doesn't like chocolate. And it's a way of meeting people's needs. Equity is a very important part of inclusive education. And it's why we have our one plans, you know, addressing equity, making sure that children have adjustments that are individualised for them. So it's really important that we're involved in discussing equity, that we understand that that is an important part of inclusive education and it's an important part of students feeling welcomed and valued. And here's a nice quote from Aristotle. Equals should be treated equally and unequals unequally. And that dates back to Aristotle 2,000 years ago. So it's quite an old concept, the concept of equity. But it's really important for our schools and classrooms. And so what action will you take in terms of the concept of equity and making it part of your allyship for students with disability? And not a bystander. I'm not a bystander in the education of children and students with disabilities and am willing to express how children and students with disability bring value to schools. So I think that's really important. That's a key part of being an ally. If we try and be neutral and not be involved, then, you know, the standard you walk past is the standard you accept. Encouraging you not to be a bystander and to express that inclusive education is important, students with disabilities are important, and that they do bring value to our schools. And this is a slide, it's a bit in depth, so the old iceberg analogy, but there's a whole lot of microaggressions that occur for marginalised groups and certainly for students with disabilities. Below the bottom of the iceberg are all the microaggressions, using ableist language, assuming inherent qualities or abilities, the whole myth of meritocracy, being treated as a second-class citizen, ignoring or denying differences. When we say that we don't see a child's disability, that is problematic because it actually means we're not willing to make adjustments for their disability. If we deny our personal bias, that is also problematic because we all are inherently biased. Assuming that everyone is homogenous, that we're all the same, that is problematic because we need to see disability and we need to value disability, assuming the normality and superiority of non-disabled people. And that is just in our society. You know, we value speech over sign language. We value speech over using devices to communicate. We value walking over using a wheelchair. There are normative views, normative behaviours that are considered superior, and they're not necessarily the case. Refusing to acknowledge lived experience. So inferiority or pathology of marginalised disability identities or cultures. So viewing someone with a disability or a group of people with a disability as a deficit. An ascription of intelligence. They are all microaggressions, and they can sort of bubble over to hate speech, violence, abuse and neglect. And we're certainly hearing a lot of cases in the Disability Royal Commission, which are really frightening. There's been lots of cases of disabled people who have experienced violence and abuse. Most unfortunate. And if we address microaggressions early, the research indicates that we can stop this overt discrimination. So what action will you take in regards to that? So building relationships, and we all know that relationships are at the core of education. They are really, really important. So I intentionally build relationships and actively listen to people with disability who are the experts on their lives. And I think I've said that numerous times throughout this presentation, but it's really important that we get our information from disabled people about what disabled lives are like. That's really important. So if we're watching a movie or we're reading a book, it's really good to question who produced the movie, who wrote the book. There are some great books around that are written by own voices literature. People who have a disability, and it's called Own Voices Literature, and they talk about their experiences at school and just in general. And it's really good that we consider them the experts, not necessarily non-disabled people. And what action will you take in that respect? So here are some possible starting points that I will reiterate. So joining a community, I've got the Facebook group Inclusive Education in Australia. There's numerous Facebook groups, but you are most welcome to join mine if you support inclusion. Reflecting and discussing language, perhaps starting with the difference between special and inclusive education and what that means. Journaling about what you see. Are students with disability treated differently to non-disabled students for no particular reason? A good example of that is when children enter a classroom. I've seen students with a disability, and this is in general education, who have an intellectual disability, who for no particular reason have to meet up with their SSO and enter the classroom a different way. And there was no particular reason for that. So, you know, it's good to just critically reflect upon what we ask students with disability to do and whether there is a very good reason for them doing something different to everybody else. And there may be times that it's really important that they are treated differently. But there may be lots of occasions, like in that case, where the student could have entered the classroom in the same way as everybody else. You can follow people with disability online. Carly Finlay has a huge following on Twitter, and she's compiled a book written by people with disability. It's an anthology. We've had people in South Australia who've written about their experience in South Australian schools. So, and that book is called Growing Up Disabled in Australia. So that's a good one to read. Jessica White is a lecturer at UniSA who writes about being deaf. And she's written a book that has won numerous awards called Hearing Maud. It was the best book that I read last year. It was really well done. And Jessica has a PhD and is a lecturer at UniSA. And I encourage you to check her book out. And Robert Hogue wrote a book called Ugly, which I would encourage you to read rather than the book Wonder, which was written by a non-disabled person. Or if you want to do Wonder, read it with Robert Hogue's book alongside as a comparative text, because Robert lives with facial difference, as does Carly Finlay. And it's really important to have their perspective. And what I've said numerous times throughout this talk, listen to people with lived experience of disability. So we're at the end here, and so I'll just revisit the learning intention and success criteria. So the learning intention was to introduce the concept and practice of being an ally as a means of instigating cultural change required for successful, inclusive education. The success criteria is I can state at least one action I can immediately implement in order to be an ally to students with disability. So is there one thing you could do tomorrow after listening to this presentation? And number two, I can name at least one long-term goal to work toward in order to be an ally to students with disability. And I hope there is one thing that is long-term you can work towards. So thank you very much for listening to this.